completamente la curva cristallo.
The sport as we know it is born in Italy.
Curva 100, labirinto, tre curve del labirinto.
On a track cut into the mountain of an Italian ski village.
Curva Valletta in curva d'arrivo.
Alla Belvedere, Bandion.
One of their own became the best who ever lived. One who knew no other way than to live life as a blur, negotiating treacherous turns with a gorgeous mastery, defying gravity and punishment, living not for glory or notice, but only for the cause of making every second count.
He was just that good. Anything to do with the Alps, Monty would have been good at. He was a mountain man, and he knew around Cortina, and he'd never really been anywhere else.
Eugenio Monti, the greatest bobsledder who ever lived, is buried at the center of his beloved mountain village, Cortina d'Ampezzo. Only after his sports career was their marriage to Linda Constantine, an American. Monti raised his family in this alpine paradise, including a daughter, Amanda. She knew only the father, not the athlete.
My father never really showed me anything. He put all of his trophies away in big cardboard boxes and never displayed them.
What she's learned of the world championships and Olympic medals and one famous shining act of sportsmanship when her father came to the aid of a competitor he knew might defeat him, all this she's had to learn from others.
He had this, what you would say in Italian, fascino. Just the look in his sparkly little blue eyes that he had, and he would kind of look at me and smile in that special way, and okay, you know, and even his friends would say the same, that he had this way of talking to you and making you feel important.
Once together, they cheated death in a bygone sports brotherhood, centered around a charismatic figure who lived by a contradictory code of unceasing competitiveness and endless generosity. Eugenio Monti is still alive with them today. With Marino Zardini, who witnessed the unwavering work ethic as his first teammate and lifelong business partner. England's Tony Nash, now a country squire, who knew profoundly the astonishing generosity, tutored by Monti to an Olympic championship. Nash's teammate, Robin Dixon, now a member of parliament, who asked for help at the worst possible time because he knew exactly how Monti would answer. And Canadian, Victor Emery, entrepreneur, adventurer. He too speaks of his debt to this one man. Then there's the essential, Sergio Sir Pais, brakeman, Monti mechanic, who never left Cortina or Monti's side.
Ecco, io quando correvo con lui, io avevo fiducia, eccetera, perché lui ti considerava. E lui sempre, il suo equipaggio, lo considerava come se stesso.
He always had a smile on his face and was always receptive. And never seemed to not have time to answer foolish questions.
None of us quite understood, as often happens with a genius, why he was so good. And everybody always wants to know how Eugenio did it.
Perché aveva l'intelligenza, la costanza, la volontà, e era forte come un leone, aveva una forza nelle gambe e nelle braccia incredibile. Non era normale, era più del normale. Era tarchiato, era forte, aveva tutto, insomma. Per me aveva tutto. Aveva tutto.
We found so many pictures of him doing other sports. I had no idea.
Monti, the natural athlete from this mountain village, is naturally first a skier, preparing to compete for Italy at the 1952 Oslo Olympic Games. Then, as so often happens, injury concludes this chapter as it barely begins.
Here he is with Zeno Collin, the famous Italian skier that he was actually able to beat, and then he injured himself and couldn't compete anymore, tore up all of his ligaments, and had to be operated on. And here's a picture of him in the hospital. And he had to see all of his good friends go to the Olympics, and he couldn't go.
Quando hai cominciato a fare il bob?
Nel 54.
E come mai sei arrivato al bob?
Ma prima facevo delle gare di sci, poi ho avuto un incidente, ho smesso proprio di, non di sciare, ma di fare delle gare. E poi così per caso, dato che a Cortina c'è una pista, ho chiesto perché non provi con un amico. Abbiamo...
At home, below the ski slopes of Cortina, it was only a matter of time before thrill seeker Eugenio Monti would find the bobsled run. And only a matter of time before he'd find his way to the Olympic Games. The 1956 Winter Games are in Cortina, on his very track. Monti is a double silver medalist, but in the two-man, he's beaten by Della Costa's aerodynamically superior sled, tested and refined by the Italian Air Force. It's a remarkable first effort, but for Monti, unacceptable.
Uno corre per vincere, io credo. La mentalità sua era di correre per vincere.
By 1958, Monti is regarded undoubtedly as the best in his sport. Then, at that year's World Championships in Garmisch, Germany, his unwavering sense of fairness makes him fully heroic. As usual, the Germans are maximizing their home snow advantage.
Monti knew, and the rest of us knew, that the Germans would pack in the snow into the track so that Monti would go down very slowly on his first run. And of course everybody else would speed up as the snow got scattered. And sure as eggs is eggs, that night the Germans piled in the snow. And about 1 o'clock in the morning, Monti and his teammates came along with shovels and shoveled it all out.
Penso, abbiamo spalato finché è arrivato lì un poliziotto col cane e noi zitti, zitti, perché lui non gli abbiamo detto non ci riconosce, no? E con la lampada faceva così e noi avevamo il berretto con la macchina, non ci conoscevano. E poi chi siete? Allora Eugenio fa, sono io, sono Eugenio. Ah, sei tu, allora lì.
The next morning, Monti and his team go back to compete, as if nothing had happened. But by now, all of Garmisch knows of their midnight mission. The Italians are immediately disqualified.
E lì ci hanno squalificati e tutta la gente quando andavamo giù per la pista, eccoli là, gli italiani che vengono su a sabotare la pista.
Even Time magazine makes note of Monti's nocturnal snow grooming. But after Germany goes 1-2 on a rigged course, the rest of the bobsledding world cheers their Saint Eugenio.
We gave him a silver shovel after that because we hated the Germans like hell.
Eugenio ha detto, l'ha detto che i dirigenti, ha detto io a Garmisch non correrò mai, mai più.
But Eugenio Monti is eager to go to America, where at the 1960 Winter Games in Squaw Valley, California, he's sure to land the Olympic title he's waited 4 long years to claim. The 1960 Squaw Valley Olympics are to be the scene of Monti's crowning. He's well established as the world's top driver. But here's a galling twist of fate. The bobsled competition is canceled by cash-strapped American organizers. With no other major championship scheduled that year, the Italians, fearing the sport's demise, create one of their own.
To keep bobsledding going, the Italians, who were all powerful in bobsledding, decided to hold the World Championships at Cortina.
Cortina has always had its problems with the weather, and the ice and snow turned to rain, and they're rather bad news, a lot of young bobbers knocking about at Alpine Village with nothing much to do. So somebody had the sense to get them out of the place, and they ordered up some buses, and we all went down to Venice.
on the way, we cooked up the idea of having a race through the canals of Venice. At a certain moment on our watches, whichever gondola we were in, we would commandeer from the gondolier.
Gondola racing with pans and oars and this, that, and the other. So whole of the British team in one gondola and whole of the Italian team in another gondola.
Racing each other down the Grand Canal in bobsleigh, crash helmets.
We narrowly escaped the clutches of the police before we were through.
And the trophy was bought by the losers and drunk by all.
It was then, really, that the friendship blossomed. And it was then we got to know the Italians very well indeed. We used to sort of bobsleigh quite hard and party quite hard.
On the famed bobsled run at Cortina d'Ampezzo is the World's Bobsled Championship competition with four-man teams from a dozen different nations hurtling down the treacherous chute.
After the inventive frivolity at bobsled's substitute Olympics, the weather finally cooperates, and Monty is, as expected, dominant, winning both the two- and four-man events.
Monty, il magnifico.
An intense competitor, he is also openly generous. What commences next in the world of bobsledding is the establishment of Monty University, an ongoing tutorial Monty provides to any and all interested.
Quando c'è uno che emerge in qualche sport, ci sono il gruppo che lo copia, il cane che tira la slitta, tutti gli altri cani lo seguono perché devono tirare come lui, devono...
Monti, ti chiamano il teorico del bob. Cosa c'è di vero in questa definizione?
È di vero, in tanti anni che corro col bob qualcosa ho ben imparato, che tu guardando la pista decidi dove, pensi dove dovresti passare, poi il difficile è passare dove vorresti passare, no? Perché andare col bob non è difficile, non è difficile scendere col bob, è difficile fare un tempo buono.
I realized that here was the master, so I spent as much time as I could when it seemed to be convenient to him, and it always seemed to be convenient, walking up the run and asking him how he took that corner and what do you do here and this kind of thing. And he was always receptive.
One thing he told me, he said, Tony, always walk up the track after the run and you always learn something. And every time after that I walked up the run.
For Canada's Vic Emery, the full educational epiphany occurs when Monty, incredibly, invites him to ride shotgun.
I spent all of my time looking over his shoulder, trying to see what he was doing differently than what I was doing. And I came to realize that I had been trying to be too perfect on the corners. He took whatever came to him without guiding it in those last 10 or 15 meters. And immediately, this new concept of driving straight into the corner and taking what comes, we were right up there amongst the leaders, top five.
What compensation Monty receives from his sport as educator and standard of excellence is paid in trophies and high regard, but there's no money in it. By day, he's building a business, operating ski lifts, and grooming the slopes of Cortina's daunting, fashionable Dolomites. While preparing for the 1964 Innsbruck Olympics, Monty is badly shaken when a carpenter dies, electrocuted while working during a rainstorm at one of his ski lifts. It comes as he's nearing exhaustion, training intensely, and also working feverishly to finish a new lift by Christmas.
Ha lavorato da matti, giorno e notte. Era uno anche inaffatico, che non cedeva mai. Lui doveva finirlo a tutti i costi. È arrivato alle Olimpiadi stanco anche mentalmente tutto. E lì non riusciva ad andare come era abituato ad andare.
He is an 8-time world champion, at the top of his sport for nearly a decade now. But on the eve of the 1964 games, exhausted, yet what is to come will define the man. A story centering around a simple bolt and a broken sled.
It was a year without snow. When we drove over the mountain and we saw Innsbruck below us for this wonderful Winter Olympic year, it was all brown.
And the downhill course was being made by lorries, hundreds of Austrian army lorries, carrying snow from one of the peaks somewhere else that had got snow. And so they made the course, and if you made a mistake, you were going to go off into something fairly solid.
Innsbruck's all-natural track is pieced together with 20,000 blocks of ice, but as such, terribly vulnerable to any warming in the weather. In the two-man, after the first of four runs over 2 days, the heavily favored Monty finds he's being outraced by his students, the English team of Tony Nash and Robin Dixon, who sit above him on the leaderboard. Then, with the second run in progress, brakeman Dixon discovers there's a very big problem. One of the essential back axle bolts, which attach the runners to the sled, has sheared. The Englishman will be done in Innsbruck without a replacement.
And we had spares for everything, but we didn't have spares for that at that particular point. And the second run was about to start, and Eugenio Monti was actually on the start line. But because of our relationship with the Italians over the years, the first people I went to for help was the Italian engineer. And he came over and looked, and Eugenio saw the fuss going on and came across to me and said, "Robin, what's the matter?" And I showed him. And he had his helmet and everything on, gloves on. And he said, "Don't worry, get an Englishman to meet me at the bottom and you can have mine because I finish for today when I get down."
Monty brakeman and all-around mechanic Sergio Sierpaiz gets the bolt to a waiting English team member.
Io ho smontato questo bulone, gliel'ho dato. Ma era una cosa naturale, neanche non... Era un piacere che facevi a uno che conoscevi, che facevamo lo stesso sport praticamente. E senza sta gran rivalità come che è adesso che...
At the end of day one, the repaired English sled is leading. Imagine, once upon a time, for one man, this was how it was. Fairness above all.
After the second run, we were all chatting, and I went up to Monty and said, "Thank you very much, you know, marvelous gesture." And he just shrugged and, yeah, it's just one of those things.
Hi, I'm Kurt Gowdy here at the finish line of the bobsled course in Eagle. Big crowd on hand now to watch the fourth and deciding run of the two-man bobsled championship.
On the second and concluding day of the two-man, the weather suddenly warms and the ice quickly softens. England's Nash and Dixon, early in the starting order, record their slowest run of the competition.
Hey, she's bumping, he's losing. Nash bumped on the straightaway. It would cost him the two-man championship. That has been his poorest run of four runs. He is the leader as of right now, but the two Italians, Zardini and Monti, are coming up behind him.
We disappeared down to the cafe at the bottom and got ourselves a schnapps and a coffee and waited for the others to come down.
And then somebody from our team, Guy Rennick, I think, found us. And he said, he swore at us. He said, "What the hell are you buggers doing here?" He said, "The world press are looking for you. You're going to win this race."
So we went up there to watch Monty. And Monty can walk on water, you know, whatever the track is. He can usually adjust to it and come down smiling.
He's into the straightaway for the finish. Monty bumping.
But even the miraculous Monty can't work magic on ice becoming slush.
A four time, the slowest run for Eugenio Monti, who usually comes through.
Tony Nash did not win because I gave him a bolt, Monty says. Tony Nash won because he was the better driver.
Tony, you beat a great man today, Eugenio Monti, 8 times the world champ. Eugenio Monti, come on in, Eugenio.
Very good friend of mine.
On the day, I drove better than him. I had the luck of the draw with the weather. But we beat him and Sardini fair and square. But the bolt is a magical story of sportsmanship, which should never be forgotten.
I didn't drive well.
You didn't drive well.
I believe also if the course was slower, I didn't win. Because Tony did drive terrific this year.
Quando mi hanno detto, guarda che, sì, va bene, con questo, ma è venuto fuori una storia che adesso...
And the bronze medalist the former world champion, many times world champion, Eugenio Monti, and Sergio Tsiafas, the brakeman. Monti getting out next to Robin Dixon there, and he's helped the British boys a great deal, and in fact, of course, was responsible for lending them the bolt that might
have delayed their start. It was a typical Eugenio Monti spontaneous gesture, and I took it as it was. Afterwards, as the world knows, we did do quite a lot to make quite a fuss of it, because, gosh, it was a fantastic sporting gesture.
He has paid a rather high price to keep faith with his principles. Even so, the Innsbruck Games are not over. In the four-man bobsled, Monti will have one more chance to win. Finally, his first gold.
Ha chiesto a me questo bulone, perché io non ho mica fatto niente di particolare, come dicono, come facevo dirgli no, ti do un bulone, non è mica sportivo, no? Sì, dico, quando arrivo giù, gli chiamo il bulone del mio bob e te lo do, no?
This was given to my father after Innsbruck of 64 from Tony Nash and Robin Dixon. And this was given to him by the Canadian team. It says, to Eugenio, in recognition of a great sportsman, Canada Bob. Did you see the inside? The last drop. The hanging man.
At Innsbruck in 1964, the four-man competition is underway. Team Canada, who've also been schooled at Monti University, find themselves in desperate trouble.
I walked up the run as I would normally do, between heats, and when I got to the top, our sled was upside down, being worked on. But then I realized it was being more than just worked on, it was a part. And that's when Eugenio's mechanics were trying to de-seize our axle.
A battered undercarriage has dangerously compromised the steering. Monti instructs Team Italy to provide on-the-spot repair.
Mi chiamavano, io andavo e imparavo che fosse, so, non i svizzeri, perché i svizzeri un po' carognetti, mettiamo quei spagnoli che c'erano, con gli inglesi, con gli americani, con cosa, Sergio, fai pure, c'è qualcosa che non va, vieni a dare un'occhiata. Era naturale andare lì e metterglielo a posto e controllare.
And we've had a tremendous upset in the four-man bobsled competition. Monti, Zardini of Italy were the heavy favorites, but Canada came through with a tremendous upset.
Canada wins gold, Monti bronze.
We certainly owe it to the Italians. They've taught us everything we knew, and it's gone back a long time. And if there's one chap that I wouldn't have mind being beaten by, was Eugenio Monti. And I hope that maybe he won't retire, because he certainly deserves more than he got in this championship.
Well, that's very gracious of you to say that.
At the time, I was very grateful that he helped us in so many ways to allow us to get to that point. He was a little bit sad, I suppose, on reflection, that he got the bronzes only. But he took it, as you would expect him to take it, absolutely pleased for us, and seemingly pleased to get his medals.
Word of his selfless acts in Innsbruck quickly spreads. In the spring of 1965, the newly formed International Committee for Fair Play makes Monti the first recipient of the de Coubertin Medal. It's the highest honor for sportsmanship in all of athletics. But he is 37 years old, denied Olympic gold by fate four times already, in 52 and 56, 60 and 64. And the next games in Grenoble, France, are three long years away.
Eugenio Monti, terminate le Olimpiadi di Innsbruck, continuerà a correre o si ritirerà?
No, ho pensato già di ritirarmi, che si diventa vecchi è meglio smettere, e andrò, curerò i miei skilift a Cortina.
Come vanno gli allenamenti?
My father was also a businessman, and he was the first in Italy to bring a snowcat from the States. And this is a picture of him with the snowcat, and it's a old Tucker snowcat from Oregon. They took it apart And I think the Air Force put it on one of their cargo planes and brought it over.
With all tasks, great and small, Monty's perfectionism is comprehensive. He wants to be the best and the first.
My father was, he was very, you would say in Italian, pignolo, which in English, the closest word that I could come up with is he was a perfectionist. Like, for example, he would cut his own wood and stack it outside of the house. Well, I would help him do that, and he just wanted every single piece to be perfectly placed and put in a specific area in a specific way, and if you didn't do it that way, he would tell you.
He would spend the summer walking the slope and taking every single stone off that hillside so that it was absolutely smooth and perfect when the snow came. He knew what he wanted and how he wanted to do it, and worked at it and lived it.
Monty doesn't compete in 1965, but when the World Championships come back to his Cortina in 1966, he is there. Of course, his fellow Montaneros tell the hometown hero that he owes it to the community. But there's also a competitive fire that can't be quenched. Monty begins one more campaign for that elusive Olympic gold by winning yet another world title. But the death of Germany's Toni Penzberger is the dreadful headline of the competition.
It was, I don't say one of those things, but it was something that occurred in bobsleigh. We usually had 2 or 3 deaths a year.
Their sport forced them to confront their mortality at nearly every turn. Only weeks after Penzberger's death, an Italian sledder dies in an even more horrific accident at Lake Placid.
Senti, ma tu conoscevi la pista di Lake Placid?
Ma no, non è una pista difficile, è una pista pericolosa, perché è più larga delle nostre in genere, delle piste europee, molto più larga di Lake Placid. Sono quelle notizie che uno spera sempre che non siano vere, insomma, sono rimasto così male ieri sera quando l'ho saputo.
Sai perché affronti questi rischi? E allora li accetti. Tu ti devi creare, cosa che a te non può capitare niente. Perché se incominci a pensare che a te può succedere qualcosa, allora non rendi neanche. Ecco, la gran soddisfazione quando l'avevi fatta perché avevi affrontato il pericolo e ti era andata bene. Allora ti dà una gioia immensa. Questo ti dà una gioia.
But danger's shadow soon overtakes Monty's loyal brakeman as well. Sir Paese's career ends abruptly at the 1967 World Championships.
Il bob per aria è uscito per aria e si è girato sotto sopra e ha picchiato sull'altra curva sotto sopra. E poi è andato ruzzolo. E io avevo questo braccio qui, e questo qui avevo.
Silvers when he loses to the better sled in Cortina, the sport snubbed in Squaw Valley, bronzes in 1964, his brakeman never to compete again. It must seem to Monty his Olympic gold will never come. Monty must build a new team, conjure new ways to win. And with the push becoming ever more important in the sport, he recruits young men with size and speed. There's Roberto Zandanella, like Monty, a compulsive athlete whose insatiable thrill-seeking leads him to the bob. Monty also taps a complete outsider, a sprinter from Rome, Luciano De Paolis.
De Paolis?
Chi è De Paolis? Di dov'è?
Di Roma.
Roma. E com'è finito qui De Paolis?
Beh, sono militare, sono venuto con l'aeronautica.
Certo che la scelta di Monty la impegna molto, eh?
Senz'altro.
They learn the Monty way, work, work, and more work. To prepare for competitions, they spend hours buffing Monty's Swedish steel runners, using lamb's wool and sandpaper.
Quindi una carta che lucidava, il pattino diventava uno specchio
lucido, diciamo, per avere la possibilità di rendere maggiormente veloce, con i quali appunto Eugenio quasi quasi ci dormiva la notte con i pattini sotto affinché non potessero essere né scalfiti né rubati.
Slick runners, fast teammates. Monty comes up with another way to increase the sled speed. He's kept the retired Sir Pais close by his side. They brainstorm bobsled's very first push bar.
Sempre parlando e discutendo, perché parlavamo spesso per migliorare le cose, per poter rendere di più, per avere una spinta più potente.
Dai, errore.
E allora dice, fai qualcosa, preparami qualcosa che proviamo, no? E allora ho fatto questo tubo canocchiale, l'ho montato e avevamo visto che guadagnavamo qualche centesimo.
1952. He was a boy skier headed to the Oslo Games until injury intervened. And now, 1968, 5 Olympics later, he is 40. And the Winter Games in Grenoble, France, will be the end of his athletic life, gold or not. The Grenoble Games, starring Jean-Claude Killy and Peggy Fleming, and Eugenio Monti, 9-time world champion. In 1956, at his very first games, Eugenio Monti was at a technological disadvantage, using an inferior sled. But at Grenoble, in all respects, Team Monti is at the sport's leading edge, highlighted by the brand new push bar.
Questi due stratagemmi venivano coperti con un telone. Veniva coperto col telone e tutti curiosi, tutte le altre nazioni curiose, naturalmente si aggiravano attorno. Addirittura c'è stata una macchietta in cui De Paulis, noi frenatori, con un fucile finto aggiravamo i nostri bob per proteggere questo nostro segreto.
Though Monty's got the best equipment, the circumstances are still hardly perfect. He's 40 years old. This will surely be his last chance at gold. And his 25-year-old rookie brakeman, the outsider from Rome, is predictably a bundle of nerves.
Before start take the air inside the lungs. And maybe think about, I represent the Italy, a small country. I must assure to the rest of the world that we are strong.
The two men is first, and Monti takes the early lead. But the Grenoble track is fundamentally flawed, built facing the sun. Defending Olympic champion Dixon recalls summer games in winter.
We were playing water polo outdoors in the swimming pool, which was just heated by the sunshine. So it wasn't surprising that there was nothing more than a trout stream coming down the bow run.
In sloppy conditions, brakeman De Paulis is told by Monti to strip off the driver's goggles if visibility becomes an issue.
And I think if now I take off the goggles and break the concentration of Eugenio, everybody kill me.
To avoid the sun, organizers find a simple solution. They start day two competition before dawn. In the third run, Monti is overtaken by Germany's Horst Plot.
Eugenio called me Romoletto because I come from Rome. And he said to me, you know, Romoletto, I will give all my medal for one Olympic gold medal.
In a final clutch run, Monti drives to a track record. Then there's confusion. The Germans and the Italians have the same overall time. Just when it seems Monty's strange and tortured Olympic history is about to continue, overdue justice prevails. Bobsled officials check the rules. Monti wins outright gold based on having the fastest single run.
First gold medal, Eugenio Monti, Luciano De Paulis, Italy.
He's waited through four Olympics, 16 years, to take this final step.
said, fool the Germany guys. They, why they don't give a gold medal to this poor guy? We have the same time. I said, okay, it's better only for us.
In the foreman, weather once again interferes. Threatened with more warming temperatures, officials cut the competition preemptively to 2 runs. Monty edges Austria 1 to win gold medal number 2.
The comfort zone for us was Eugenio 1. You know, we said, well, he was always going to win sometime, and it's great that he has won. And Tony and I were very happy about that. Very happy indeed.
L'inno nazionale, come diciamo così, viene inizia, come comincia ad essere suonato, un brivido percorre tutta la stinta. Un pochino sì. Si ha questa sensazione, si è partecipi di coloro che sono sul gradino più alto e quindi sono stati gli autori di un così grande evento storico.
E allora abbiamo cambiato il nome alla Sciovia, invece che Monti Zardini, Sciovia Olimpia. E abbiamo messo i circhi olimpi sulla Sciovia. E ha cambiato nome. Cambiato nome.
Few athletes conclude their career at the summit of their sport. Fewer still with a legacy of such excellence and character. In retirement, Monty stays home in his beloved Cortina, but hardly rests. Turns his energies fully to building his ski business and starting a family. Then, life's curves are too many and come too fast. And Monty the man finds he is suddenly helpless. His son dies, age 23. He's divorced, finally slowed to a halt by Parkinson's.
A person like my father, very active, independent, to find himself not able to do the things that he used to do, to have to ask for help, it was extremely hard for him.
Era solo dopo, era solo. Non poteva più andare avanti così. Non che non avesse più coraggio, non aveva più voglia di vivere, credo, così.
In December of 2003, Eugenio Monti takes his own life.
From the stories that I've heard from my father's friends that came through this house throughout the years that I was growing up, and from what I remember, they definitely shared something special together.
Like it was yesterday, they remember a youth when they were never so alive. And they remember reverently the man at the center of it all.
Despite his quirkiness and his idiosyncrasies, he was always loved and always there and always brilliant. And I think he's a legend, and he will remain a legend.
His legacy is, of course, far beyond bobsledding. His extreme sportsmanship is something to be looked at by all sports, and all sportsmen. He didn't want to win unless he was winning against the best. And if the best were handicapped by something that he could help them with, give it to them, so that if I won, I won fairly. That's a great legacy.